All right. We're going to talk about the past again, why it is so important for us, and we need to realize, I know the church wants to tell you that our past has been done away with, but scripture says they are liars and the truth ain't in them. Let's go to, what is that, 2 John 2, 4 through 6, I think it is.
All right. 1 John, isn't it? Yeah, it says 1 John. Mm-hmm. 1 John 2, beginning in verse 4. But he who says, I know him, and does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, truly the love of Yahweh is perfected in him. By this we know that we are in him. He who says he abides in him ought himself also to walk just as he walked.
So that's important to us to know that the past is so important. And so if you look at the board, you can see that your past can propel you forward or can hold you back. The choice is whose? Yours. So don't go to blaming other people. We should be grown-ups, and we should be able to let it propel us forward and not hold us back. Kim, could you write one more thing up here? Better and bitter. And so your past can make you better or bitter. It depends on how you handle your past. And so it's very important that we see our past is important because it is our reference point. And without a reference point, you'd be like a ship at sea, just going in circles and going in circles and going in circles. And it's like Israel. They kept going around the mountain and around the mountain. And finally, Yahweh said, hey, you've been at this mountain too long. You made them get away from there. And so many times when we don't have a reference point, we don't know where we're going, don't know where we came from, don't know what we're looking for. And even the children of this world are wiser than the children of light in this matter, because the world knows how important the past is. For example, if you go to your doctor, what's he looking for? And where does he find what's wrong?
In your chart.
Correct. He begins to ask you, did your parents have this? Did you have this? Did you experience this? They always go back to your past, your history. Doctors know that. All right. If you were to go to court and you got a good prosecuting attorney and a good defensive attorney, what are they looking for? Past. See, they know that, the world knows that your past is so important to you. That's what they go looking for, to either make you guilty or make you innocent. All right, the stock market. What do they go looking for? Past performance. Why? Because it's an indicator of future events. See, so the world understands that. And yet, religion tells you our past is done away with, or the Old Testament is done away with. Really? You just, Mr. Fred would say, you big dummy, you just threw away your reference point. That's so important that we know what a reference point is. Let's say you were in a big aircraft carrier, and you're at sea, and either the Atlantic, Pacific, or whatever one of those oceans you want to be in, how do they chart where they're at? What's some things up in the sky? They look at the stars, the sun, and the moon to get exactly where they're at. And that's how they guide themselves. So they're, and the stars and the sun and the moon is our past. They were created long, long. Let's go to Genesis chapter 1. It's the fourth day, I believe it is. And yeah, somewhere in there.
All right, Genesis 1, beginning in verse 14. And Elohim said, let there be lights in the firmaments of the heavens to divide the day from the night. Let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. And let them be for lights in the firmament of the heavens to give light upon the earth. And it was so.
So when they look at the stars, they're looking at the past. Because they've been there billions of years. Who knows how long they've been there. And so they go back and look at the past to see where they're at or their reference point. And so that's why our past is so important. Remember, it can propel you forward and make you better, or it can hold you back and make you bitter. It depends on how you treat your past. Let's go to Luke 16 and 8.
Luke 16 and 8. And the master commended the unjust steward because he had done wisely. For the children of this world are in their generation wiser than the children of light.
See, the world knows I need to know about the past in order to take care of the present, in order to take care of the future. And yet religion tells us that our past has been done away with. But that cannot be true, because if our past is done away with, we can't not connect the dots. There is no reference point. And that's what they're trying to do with our kids in school. They're trying to take away their past so they can't. Here's the thing, so they can't discern truth from error. That's what your past does. It helps you discern truth from error. And this is so important that we understand that. And we're gonna look at it a little deeper to understand my past is so important. In fact, the older we get, what do we look at? Oh, really? So, because some of the things back there, we remember, oh, I remember I done that, and it worked. I'll try it again. Yeah. Or we found something. I better not do that, because it didn't work. What makes inventors great? They're always looking at their, go ahead.
They're building on the past.
Correct. Thomas Edison, Alexander Bell, George Washington Carver, Eli Whitney, and all these inventors and things, they always went back to look at their past in order to propel them forward, because the past told them one thing, what not to do. This didn't work. How many see that? And this did work. This part of that worked, that part didn't. And so what did they do? They kept getting rid of it, getting rid of it, what didn't work, to find out what worked. And that's why we got these smartphones, and we got LED lights, and all this fine cotton and peanut butter and all these different things, because somebody had to go back and look at the past. Now, show you one more thing. You got $1 million home. Let's make it good. You got a $10 million home. And what is the first thing they do? What would they do? This lady next door does it.
She draws up
a blueprint or a set of plans. Now, I am a contractor. What do I have to do? I have to keep going back to the plans. I have to keep going back to the plans to make sure I'm getting things according to the plan. Now you understand why Yahweh told them, seek ye the old path. Go back and look at the reference point, and you know where you missed it, and you know where you're making it. What's that scripture? Jeremiah, what is it? I have it here somewhere, but today it's trying to elude me. And so that's what, yeah, that's it, sounds like it.
All right, Jeremiah 6 and 16. Thus says Yahweh, stand in the ways and see, and ask for the old paths, wherein is the good way, and walk therein, and you'll find rest for your souls. But they said, we will not walk there.
And so they had gotten so far off from the right way that Yahweh was telling them, If you want to please me, go back and look at the old past. Go back to your reference point, and you know whether you're missing it and when you're hitting the mark. When Yahushua came, it was the same way. They were so far off the path. He told them, you take the traditions of men and teach them as if they were the word of Elohim. And so they were so far off that it didn't look like what Moses wrote. And that's why Yahushua came, to take them back. That's why he said in Matthew 5:17, think not. Now, if the master, the Messiah said, think not, what do we ought to be doing? Think not.
Matthew 5:17. Think not that I'm come to destroy the law or the prophets. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
And that word fulfill means to establish, to build up, to bring back into view, because it got so far out of view that it didn't look like what Moses wrote. In fact, let me get this scripture. Let's go to John chapter 8. Ma'am? Correct, because they refused to go back to the reference point. Let's start at John 8:31. Listen to this.
John 8:31.
It's about 10 verses there we need to read, so hang on.
John 8:31. Then Yahushua said to those Yehudim which believed on him, if you continue in my word, then you are my disciples indeed. And you shall know your truth, and the truth shall make you free. And they answered him, we be Abraham's seed, but we are never in bondage to any man. How do you say you shall be made free? And Yahushua answered them, verily I say to you, whoever commits sin is the servant of sin. And the servant does not abide in the house forever, but the Son does. If the Son therefore shall make you free, then you shall be free indeed. I know that you're Abraham's seed, but you seek to kill me, because my word has no place in you. I speak that which I have seen with my father, and you do that which you have seen with your father. And they answered unto him and said, Abraham is our father. And Yahushua said to them, if you were Abraham's children, you would do Abraham's works. But now you seek to kill me, a man that has told you the truth, which I've heard of Yahweh. Abraham did not do this.
So they don't even look like Abraham, do they? Because Yahushua just told me, if you were Abraham's seed, you would do the seeds of Abraham. Abraham was, and I forget where it's at, he said, Abraham saw my day and was glad to see it. These people weren't glad to see Yahushua, because they were losing their what? Power and control. All right, keep reading there.
They answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. And he said unto them, if you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. But now you seek to kill me, a man who told you the truth, which I've heard of Yahweh. Abraham did not do this. You do the deeds of your father. And they said to him, we're not born of fornication. We have one father, even Elohim. And Yahushua said to them, if Elohim was your father, you would love me. For I proceeded forth and came from Elohim. I did not come from myself, but he sent me. So why do you not understand my speech, even because you cannot hear my words? You are of your father, the devil.
Oh, and, wow.
And the lusts of your father you'll do. He was a murderer from the beginning and did not abide in the truth, because there's no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. And because I tell you the truth, you do not believe me.
Okay. Now, let's just back up a minute and look at this. These were supposed to be what? Believing Yehudim, Jews. But when it got down to it, they didn't believe Abraham. They didn't believe the father. And Yahushua called them, your father is who? The devil. So now, the reason why he did that, because it didn't look like what Moses wrote. What Moses wrote, they weren't doing anymore. In fact, let me give you a big hint. And if when you read in Ezekiel chapter 8 and through verse 11, you'll see that the Spirit of Yahweh left the temple way back then, because they ran him out of his own house, so to speak, because it became so corrupt. What do you see today? Churches have become, religion has become so corrupt. Some of them, you look like you don't know whether you're going into a nightclub or cafe, what? They got the fog machines and all of this stuff. You didn't see that in the tabernacle or the temple. You would have got to run out. And so there's the old adage, if you don't learn from you're doomed to. So now we want our past to propel us forward and make us better and not bitter. Some people are so bitter over their past. Something happened to them. Instead of raising their hand and say, Father, I thank you for my past, I've got to get past some of the things that happened to me in my past. How many see that? Because if you don't, they're going to hold you back. Amen. Now let's go to Matthew chapter 23 and verse 23.
Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, you hypocrites, for you pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin, and have omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith. These you ought to have done, and not to leave the other undone. You blind guides, which strain at a gnat and swallow a camel. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you make clean the outside of the cup and of the platter, but within they are full of extortion and excess. You blind Pharisee, cleanse first that which is within the cup and the platter, that the outside of them may be made clean also. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you are like unto whited sepulchres, which indeed appear beautiful outward, but are within full of dead men's bones and of all uncleanness.
Who she was talking to? The leaders of the tabernacle temple. They had gotten so far away from what Yahushua gave to Moshe that Yahushua called them, you're blind. These were the leaders. These weren't just anybody. These were the Pharisees shouldn't have been in the temple anyway. Should have been the Sadducees. Pharisees had to do with the Jews or Yehudim. Only the Levites were supposed to be in the temple, working in the temple, not the Pharisees and all these other folks. So we can see that they had strayed so far. And one portion of the scripture says, somebody find it for me, you have taught traditions of men as if it was the word of Elohim. So what they did, they made up their own things, threw away the past. See why you need your past? Because without the past, you can't tell what's truth, what's error, what's good, and what's not good. How many see that? So we want to get better and not bitter. Did you see that one?
I mean, there's one in Matthew 15.
Okay, that's probably it. Where it says he taught the traditions of men.
All right, so it says, then Yahushua came to the scribes and Pharisees, which were of Jerusalem, saying, why do your disciples transgress the traditions of the elders? For they do not wash their hands when they eat bread. And he answered and said to them, why do you also transgress the commandment of Elohim by your tradition? For Elohim commanded, saying, honor your father and your mother, and he that curses father or mother, let him die the death. But you say, whosoever shall say to his father or his mother, it is a gift, by whatsoever you might be profited by me, and honors not his mother or his father, he shall be free. Thus you have made the commandment of Yahweh of no effect by your tradition.
See, so they had strayed so far from the word of Elohim, just like today. That's why they want to get rid of it. So, because now they can use the traditions of men. In other words, they can make up their own rules and regulations and try to make you abide by them. Instead of what, ma'am? Matthew chapter 15. Instead of what Yahweh wrote. So that's important to us. We have to go back and look what Moses wrote in order to know where is religion at today. Because let's look who did what Moses wrote. The Israelites, the prophets, the psalmists, Yahushua, the apostles, and even Paul. Some people get so hooked up on Paul. And you know what I tell them when they come to me with Paul immediately? That tells me they don't know the scriptures. Yeah. That when you come to me with Paul only, I recognize that you do not know the scriptures. Because Paul himself said in 2 Timothy 3:16-17, all scripture is given by the inspiration of Yahweh and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of Yahweh may be perfect, through the thoroughly furnished unto all good works. And he didn't just say the ones I wrote, he said all scripture. And so the last time I looked, there were 66 books here.
When he wrote that,
there was no New Testament. And if you'll look at most, 85%, most scholars agree, 85%, even of the Brit Hadashah, New Testament, is a direct quote or indirect quote from the Old Testament. And if you read the book of Revelation, there's over 200 quotes from the Old Testament. And we think the Revelations is the latest thing, but he's actually quoting from where? The past. And so it's very important that we see how important our past is. Remember, it's my reference point. It tells me, am I getting off the mark? Am I straying? That's why Yahushua said, look not to the left, nor either to the right. And then we wrote the song, we're keeping our eyes on what? The prize. Because there's a lot of things going on here in peripheral, a lot of fluff, as we call it. And that's what the enemy wants. He wants you to get your eyes off the prize. And remember, if you remember Peter, he said, bid me to walk on the water. Here he come. He walk on the water. And what caused him to drown or start sinking? He began to look where? To the left and to the right. So that's why we shouldn't look to the left or the right. Keep our eyes on the prize. Now, so our past is so important because, remember, it's our reference point. A lot of people do the, what do you call that, when you go look at the history of your family? Genealogy. Where does it take you?
The past.
Oh. You find out who you are in the... You got to go see how important and... They got big websites to sell that stuff like crazy because people want to know where they came from. And the only way to find out is you go back to your past. So that's why it's so important. Your past can either propel you forward or hold you back. It depends on how you handle your past. And it helps us connect the dots. Now, we was reading in Jeremiah 6:17, where it says, seek ye the old path. But Yahushua said it this way in Matthew 11:28.
Matthew 11:28. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart. And you shall find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
So where would you find rest? Where would you find about Yahushua? In the past. There's more written about him in the past of what he would be like, where he'd be born, and all these different things, what tribe he was from, what he would do. Let's go to, what is that, Isaiah 61:1, I believe. Start there.
Isaiah 61:1, the spirit of the Master Yahweh is upon me, because Yahweh has anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of Yahweh and the day of vengeance of our Elohim, to comfort all that mourn, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beauty for ashes, and the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness.
So see what he came to do? So now we know exactly what he came to do, because we looked into the past to see what he was supposed to do, and did he do it? He did everything to a T, every one of them. So that's why it's so important we go back and we look, because if you don't go back and look, how are you gonna know? Did he do this right? Did he do that right? Did he do this right? Unless you go back. And now, what is it, Isaiah, I think it's chapter 9, where it says, to us a son is given. I think it's 9:14 tomorrow. 6, okay.
All right, Isaiah 9:6. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty El, the Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
And some people want to argue, well, he wasn't called that. But here's what you got to realize. You got to realize that one word in that sentence tells it all. And what is that word? Huh? What is that? Read it again. And I'll stop you there.
For unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. And he shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty El, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace.
So what are those are titles? But what's important to us is the name. Because name says nature, character, power, and authority. That's what's so important. That's why Yahweh said in Proverbs 30:4, he said, what is my name and my son's name, if thou canst tell? And so people want to argue, oh, he wasn't called. Yes, he did that. He was wonderful. He came from everlasting. He's the Prince of Peace. He's all those things wrapped up in Yahushua. It's just like, I think it's Matthew, what says, immerse them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Rock. So that key word there is?
Name,
thank you. In the nature of the Father, the Son, and the Ruach. So we have to see how this thing is laid out. And that's why we go seek our past to see. And especially when you go to the doctor, they'll say, did your mother have this, or did your dad have this? Did your grandma have this? And does it run in your family tree? Because they're looking at your past to see how they can help you today. Amazing what's back there. Okay.
I just, as an example, you know, I had so much trouble with my feet for a while,
mm-hmm.
you know, to the point where I couldn't even walk. And, you know, we were looking at all kinds of things. You know, I mean, did I have broke bones? Mm-hmm. Were my ligaments stretched? I was all these kinds of things, you know, and nobody could really give me, you know, we took x-ray after x-ray and, you know, just all kinds of stuff. The doctors were trying all kinds of things. And then Dr. Duffield, the same one who diagnosed mom's gallbladder issue, he asked me, he said, you know, do you have gout? Does gout run in your family? And I told him, I said, well, my dad had it. So did my grandfather and my grandmother.
See?
And so he ordered a blood test. And when he did, he said, look, we want to look for his uric acid level. When they did, it was through the roof. Mm-hmm. And he knew right then, he was like, you got gout.
Yeah.
That's why your feet are hurting so bad.
Because they went back to the past so he could help him today. That's why we go back and look at the scriptures, so they can help us today. How many see that? That's why he said, I told the end from the beginning. You go back and look, and you can tell just how far off you are, or whether you're walking right down the middle of the truth. Yes, ma'am?
You could also, in that fact, go back and look at what was done in the tabernacle,
mm-hmm.
how service was conducted, what was done, mm-hmm. and you'll see a whole bunch of stuff people are
doing
today. they would have been struck dead.
Yeah.
Because it did not happen. So you can know what's the right way for Shabbat to be handled, for service to be handled, what things should happen in there, what things should not, by just going back and looking.
Amen. So, and that's what Yahushua told them in, what was it, John 5, 45 and 46 right there. He says, had you believed Moses, you would believe me. Because what? Moses wrote of me. So that's why Yahushua said, you go back and you'll see who I am. What is that? Deuteronomy 18:18 or 18:15, I think. That's it.
Deuteronomy 18 and 15. Yahweh your Elohim will raise up unto you a prophet from the midst of you, of your brethren, like unto me. Unto him you shall hearken, according to all that you desired of Yahweh your Elohim in Horeb in the day of the assembly, saying, let me not hear again the voice of Yahweh my Elohim, neither let me see this great fire anymore, that I do not die.
So we read in John what Yahushua is verifying that Moses did. He said he would raise up a prophet like unto me. So which one was like unto Moses? Couldn't have been Joshua or any of the others, because Moses actually put down the reference points for us. Nobody else did that. Yes, ma'am? Oh, okay. You just relax. Okay. So that's why it's so important. Let's go to, see, John 14, 15.
John 14, 15 says, if you love me, keep my commandments.
So how will we know what his commandments are? You got to go back to the front of the book. To the past. In fact, one of the ones he said, In Exodus, he said, remember. In order to remember, you got to go where?
The past.
Remember the Sabbath to keep it
holy.
I got to go back and look, how did they keep the Shabbat holy? So he's telling us, go back. You'll see the right way. Don't listen to what men do. Let's go to Ephesians 4:14.
Ephesians 4 and 14. That we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, and carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive.
So there's people out there lying in wait to deceive, and they want you to get out of this book. Because this book, where was that at? Yahushua said, the gate that leads to destruction is what?
Broad.
But the gate that leads to life is
narrow.
Straight and narrow. And few there be that find it. And as the further you closer you get, the tighter the area becomes. It's just like when Balaam's ass donkey was going toward the angel. The closer he got to that angel, the narrower the path got. And finally, Balaam scratched himself up and began to beat the donkey. And the donkey was trying to save his life. See, so the path is straight and narrow. It tells us when I missed the mark. Sin means to miss the mark. It means I have gotten away from the straight and narrow, and I'm on the broad way. Why do they want the broad way? Because they can write their own rules. And they can control people on the broad way, because when you seek the straight and narrow, who's in control? Yahweh. Yeah, you can't manipulate the truth. That's why they want to get you away for it. That's what we just read in Ephesians, whereby men lie in wait to what? To deceive, to get you away from the truth. How do you think when Hasatan, just think about it, he's been in prison 1,000 years, and he's just like most criminals. When they come out, they are better criminals. They didn't learn anything. They came out better criminals. And some of them get out, and they're back in there within 24 hours. So we got to learn from our past, or we're doomed to repeat it. Remember the story of Job. Let's go to Job chapter 38 and start at verse 1. And let's see where Yahweh takes Job to ask him some questions.
Job chapter 38, beginning in verse 1. Then Yahweh answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, "Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up now your loins like a man, and I will demand of you, and you will answer me. Where were you when I laid down the foundations of the earth? Declare if you have an understanding. Who has laid the measures thereof, if you know? Or who has stretched the line upon it? Whereupon are the foundations thereof fastened? Or who laid the cornerstone thereof?"
So Yahweh said, "Job, you so smart, tell me about the past." I'm bringing it down straight and simple. He said, "Job, you're so smart, tell me about the past." He said, "When I laid the foundations, where were you? When I gave this," if you keep reading, it says, "when I gave the sea a decree, come hither and no further." See? He said, "Where were you when I did all this, Job?" Way back in the past, Job couldn't answer him because he didn't know that for about the past. And that's why we seek our past. We get a better understanding where we're at right now and where we're headed. Where we should be headed. Amen? And so the father began to ask Job, "Job, where were you when I set the sun and the moon and the stars?" He was nowhere around. But Yahweh wanted him, took him back to the past to show him how dumb he was. Amen? Sometimes we think we're so smart, and yet we're so dumb. Dumb in a rock. Look at religion. They're dumb on a rock because they refuse to go back and look what Yahweh wrote for us to do. They do just like they did he says, told them to seek the old paths, and they said, "We will not." And so let's go to Ezekiel. I'm going to show you this. Chapter 8. Let's see where I want to start. Chapter 8, verse 4.
"And behold, the glory of the Elohim of Israel was there, according to the vision that I saw in the plain. And he said to me, 'Son of man, lift up your eyes now toward the north.' So I lifted up my eyes the way toward the north, and behold, northward at the gate of the altar, this image of jealousy in the entry. And he said furthermore unto me, 'Son of man, do you see what they do? Even the great abominations that the house of Israel commits here, that I should go far off from my sanctuary?'"
Wow, you see what they did? They were so far off. He had to get up and get out of his own house. That's bad when you got to leave your own house. This was his house. But man had made it so bad. Keep reading. We're going to see how bad it is. And like we say, if you don't learn from your past, you're what? Doomed to repeat it.
"But turn yet again, and you shall see even greater abominations. And he brought me to the door of the court, and when I looked, behold, there was a hole in the wall. And he said to me, 'Son of man, dig now in the wall.' And when I dug in the wall, I beheld a door. And he said to me, 'Go in, and behold the wicked abominations that they do there.' So I went in and saw, and behold, every form of creeping thing and abominable beast, and all the idols of the house of Israel, were portrayed on the wall round about. And they stood before them 70 men of the ancients of the house of Israel.
Shane, who are the 70?
That's the Sanhedrin.
That's the so-called Sanhedrin today.
And in the midst of them stood Yaazaniah, the son of Shaphan. Every man his censer in his hand, and a thick cloud of incense went up. And he said to me, "Son of man, do you see what the house of the, what the ancients of the house of Israel do in the dark? Every man in the chambers of his imagery? For they say, Yahweh does not see us. Yahweh has forsaken the earth." And he said also unto me, "Turn yet again, and I'll show you greater abominations that they do." Then he brought me to the door of the gate of Yahweh's house, which was toward the north. And behold, there sat women weeping for Tammuz.
Who's Tammuz?
Tammuz was a Babylonian sun deity, basically.
Now, this is connected with Easter, but where are they at? All right, keep reading.
Then he said to me, "Have you seen this, O son of man? Turn yet again, and you'll see even greater abominations than these." And he brought me into the inner court of Yahweh's house, and behold, at the door of the temple of Yahweh, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men.
Who's those men? Two orders of the priests and the Kohen Hagadol, the high priest, makes 25.
With their backs toward the temple of Yahweh and their faces towards the east, and they worship the sun towards the east.
Easter sunrise, right there in the book. And yet, who does it today? It's a big thing with the church to do Easter sunrise. If you don't learn from your, you're doomed to, and they're repeating things from their past. But let's go a little further. Let me show you something. Chapter 9, Ezekiel chapter 9 and verse 3.
Ezekiel 9 and 3. And the glory of the Elohim of Israel was gone up from the cherub whereupon he was to the threshold of the house. And he called to the man clothed with linen, which had the writer's inkhorn by his side.
All right, thank you. Read Ezekiel 10 and 4.
10 and 4. Then the glory of Yahweh went up from the cherub and stood over the threshold of the house. And the house was filled with the cloud, and the court was full of the brightness of Yahweh's glory.
10:18.
Then the glory of Yahweh departed from off the threshold of the house and stood over the cherubim.
11 and 23. Ezekiel 11:23.
And the glory of Yahweh went up from the midst of the city and stood on the mountain, which is on the east side of the city.
So what you see the father doing? Leaving his own house. But you see how slow he's doing it? He's trying to get them to repent. Now you understand that at the stake, it says the veil of the temple was what? So they could see there was nothing back there. Yahweh left in Ezekiel's day. So they'd been faking it all this time. Wow. See, if you don't learn from your past, you're doomed to repeat it. What has man got? He's got a veil up there today. Mm-hmm. Nothing back there. Yeah. I got a song. I saw the man behind the curtain. See? And that's why it was rent in twain, so they could see there ain't nothing going back there. They've been faking it all these years. And what are they doing today? They're still faking it. As if they're great prophets and all of this. And I'm thinking, really? They miss it. They come back next week with something else. Oh, I want to go see the prophets. You didn't run to see the true prophet. In fact, you went the other way. I'll show you. David messed up. Who did Yahweh send to him? Nathan the prophet. Kill him. And then when Nathan said, "You the man," what did David say? "Have mercy upon me, O Yahweh. according to thy loving kindness, according to the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgression, blot out my past. That's what really the blood of Mashiach does. It blots out our past just as though it never happened. That's awesome. The blood of bulls and goats couldn't do that. But the blood of Mashiach Yahushua wipes it out just as though it never happened. That's why we need the blood. How many see that? Still today. And so the father had to leave his own house. It's gotten so bad. Now, here's the sad thing. The places that you think should be safe and you should be comfortable are some of the worst places you can go to. Boy Scouts used to be safe. Girl Scouts used to be safe. The church used to be safe. Who's the biggest child trafficker in the world? The Roman Catholic Church. Places you thought were safe. And then you throw our government in the mix. You think our leaders are for us, but they're actually against us. It's the enemy from within. And if we don't learn from our past, we're doomed to repeat it. Every great nation has fallen from within. We ain't learned it yet. All right. How many remember Stephen? He made a defense in the book of Acts chapter 7. And where did he take them? He took them all the way back to the past. Go to Acts chapter 7 and just start reading there. And we will not read it all because but it's good. The whole story is verse 1 through 60, but we're going to read a few verses so you can get the point.
All right, Acts chapter 7, beginning in verse 1. Then the high priest said, "Are these things so?" And he said, "Men, brethren, and fathers, hearken. The Elohim of glory appeared to our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia, before he dwelt in Haran. And he said to him, 'Get out of your country and from your kindred, and come into the land which I shall show you.' Then he came out of the land of the Chaldeans and dwelt in Haran. And from there, when his father was dead, he removed him into this land wherein you now dwell. And he gave him no inheritance in it, no, not so much as to set his foot on. Yet he promised that he would give it to him for a possession and to his seed after him when as yet he had no child."
So where did Stephen take him back? All the way back to the past. And he kept going and he told him about Moses and David and all. He took them all the way back and brought them up and showed them how far they had missed it. But he had to go back to the past to show them how far they had gotten away from the straight and narrow. That's why we have to go back and look. Seek ye the old paths, where is the good way, and you'll find rest for your soul. But they said, "We will not." What are they saying today? We will not. We will not go back and look, because I'll lose my power and control. But what you don't realize, you're going to lose it anyway, because when Yahushua shows up again, he ain't playing games. Go to Revelation chapter 19 and what is it, verse 11 or somewhere around there.
Revelation 19, beginning in verse 11. "And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he both judges and makes war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of Yahweh. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of El Shaddai."
He's not playing games, is he? When he comes back, we either going to be following him, I'm going to rephrase that, we're either going to be for him or against him. There ain't no middle ground here. You're either for him or against him. Now, and I think it's Revelation 20, and it said, "And I saw a great white throne," and something special happened there. What was it? Anybody want to guess? Thank you. Say it loud.
That's where they opened up the books.
Verse 12, 20, verse 12.
And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before Yahweh, and the books were open. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their work.
So what's in those books? The past. If you didn't get it under the blood of Mashiach, there it is. All your past, all your dirty clothes, all your secrets, and all whatever you're doing, it's right there. It says, and when the books were opened. Don't think your past is important? Well, we better think again. I'll show you. Go to Malachi 3 and 16, I think it is. And here's a book we can get in, and Yahweh's going to remember us every time we use the name. But this is not the book of life. This is not the judgment book. This is a book of remembrance.
Malachi 3 and 16. Then they that feared Yahweh spoke often one to another, and Yahweh hearkened, and he heard it. And a book of remembrance was written before him for them that feared Yahweh and that thought upon his name.
Wow. That's the past. He's looking at, oh, they used my name. Let's go to Revelation 3 and 8.
All right, Revelations 3 and 8. I know your works. Behold, I've set before you an open door, and no man can shut it. For you have a little strength, and have kept my word, and not denied my name.
So, you know, you have kept my word. Two things he's asking us to do. Keep his word, and not deny his name. His name is not Jesus. There were no J's in the English language until about 1584. There were none in Hebrew and Latin and Greek at the time he walked the earth. So that couldn't be his name. And that's why you see us use the name Yahushua, because he said, I come in my Father's name. And if you study scripture very much, you can see that when you read their Hebrew names, most of them, especially the prophets and the apostles, they have Yah in it or Yahoo in it somewhere. Yes, Yahoo, Yerma Yahoo. Matiyahu, see, they have his name in there. So it lets us know that that other name they're using is not his name. Mm-hmm. Sure.
Even if you look at names today, like Benjamin Netanyahu, his name means son of my right hand, and that's the first name. His last name means gift of Yahuwah.
So that's why we use this name we use, because we don't want to deny his name. Because the scripture says, he that calleth on the name shall be saved. All right. But anyway, we can see, because of this, going back, we can see how far we've gotten off, or are we on the right road, yada, yada, yada. We can connect the dots of who's doing what, who's missing the mark, and all that, because we went back and we looked at the blueprints. I'll just make it easy for you. We went back and looked at the blueprints. And I want to say one more thing about the past. Some of us, there are some things that we need to let go of. We're holding on to it. They become idols to us. And we hold on to them so dearly, we need to let go of them. I'll say it again. Some of us are holding on to the past so tight that we just can't let go. But Yahweh says, I'll come with healing in my wings. And matter of fact, he's going to make us forget about those hurtful things that we don't want to let go of. Let's go to Revelations 21. I think it's 4, where it says, and I make all things new, and their past they remember no more, or something like that.
Revelations 21 and 4, and Yahweh shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there will be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away.
See, because some of it we're holding on so dearly. But here's the one thing you need to ask yourself. Sometimes we'll hold on to people. You need to say, is that the way that person will want me to live my life today? Sometimes it's mama, daddy, sister, brother, children, and we hold on to them so dearly, but we need to ask ourselves, is that the way they would want me to live today? No, can't change it, so you might as well let it propel you forward, make you better and not bitter. How many see that? So now we got a better look at our past, but guess what? I'll end it with this. By the truth, sell it not, because it is priceless, and best is yet to come. And the best is yet to come. Abba, we love and appreciate you. Appreciate your son, Yahushua, B'shem Yahushua. Amen.
All right. We want to thank everybody for being with us here tonight in Meshkan Rock Cole's Zoom room. We love you. Appreciate you. We hope to see you back here tomorrow, 2 p.m. Central, for our normal Shabbat service. So until then, we pray you have a quiet night, a peaceful night, a restful night, a warm night. And we'll see you back here tomorrow, 2 p.m. Central. So until then, Laila Tov.